Well, welcome to this final service of April. It's amazing how we're getting through the year, isn't it? A very warm welcome to you. And today is a special day for the church. We will be having our APCM meeting after this service. If that's news to you, it's not too late. You can still sign in after the service. We'll be meeting for our APCM. We'll also be concluding our series on the cross, on the resurrection. This morning. Last week we were thinking about what it meant to die well in light of the resurrection, and this week what it means to live well. So with that in our minds, let's sing together, O Church, Arise, Living in Light of the Resurrection.
O Church, Arise. Thank you.
Of course, God calls us to arise and live in the light of the resurrection, something we don't always do, living in the now and the not yet, the tension that the Christian life experiences. Of course, we fail and we strive and we continue. But we'll now have some words on the screen, giving us an opportunity to seek the Lord, to bring our failures before him and to receive his forgiveness. So do say the words in bold with me. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked abandon their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Turn back to the Lord who will have mercy, to our God who will richly pardon. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we rejoice, blessed be the Lord, who has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. And we will praise our God in the words of our following song.
A hope that burns within my heart, that gives me strength for every passing day. A glimpse of glory now revealed in meager parts, yet drives all doubts away. I stand in Christ with sins forgiven, and Christ in me the hope of heaven. My highest calling and my deepest joy, to make his will my own. A hope that lifts my weary head, a consolation strong against despair, that when the world has plunged me in its deepest pit, I find the Savior there. Through present sufferings, just fears, he whispers courage in my ear. For I am safe in everlasting arms, and they will lead me home. A hope that stands the test of time, that lifts my eyes beyond the beckoning grave, to see the matchless beauty of a day divine, when I behold His face. When suffering ceases and sorrows die, and every longing satisfied, then joy unspeakable will flood my soul. For I am truly home.
Today's reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting at verse 1, and that can be found on page 1188 or thereabouts. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting at verse 1. Now, brothers, about times and dates we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labour pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that, whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as, in fact, you are doing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm absolutely sure that all of us have got heroes in life. I wonder who yours might be. I'd like you to imagine that you got a phone call later on today from your number one hero in life, and they said that they would like to come and meet you and spend a whole day in your company next week. Well, my goodness, that would be a treat, wouldn't it? And I'm sure you'd spend the rest of this week cutting your lawns, painting your porch, getting a haircut, ordering in some special food. You'd want to be ready for the arrival of that special guest, wouldn't you? Well, in his letter to the church at Thessalonica, the Apostle Paul is assuring Christians that there is going to come a day when they are going to meet Jesus, the greatest of all heroes. He will return in great glory to meet his people. And if you wanted to summarize the big idea of these last two chapters, it's this: that Jesus who died and who was raised will return, and we need to live now in the light of that return. Last week, if you were with us, you'll remember that we thought how this perspective of Jesus' return changes our attitude to the future. We don't need to fear death for ourselves or for our friends who are Christians, says Paul. For there will come a time when Jesus returns, when Jesus will gather all Christians, those who've died and those who are still alive. All of us will be gathered together to meet Jesus and to be with him forever. What a comfort that was as we think about dear Christians who have died. Paul wants to reassure us that they are safe, and so too are we. We will be kept together for that grand reunion where we will meet our loved ones and Jesus Christ and be with us forever. That's a great future, isn't it? And it's wonderful to rejoice that we are secure. But this week, Paul has got a different aim in view. Though his theme continues to be the return of Jesus Christ, now he wants to draw out its implications not for the future, but for the present, to see the way that it impacts the way that we live today. And you know, I think that this is going to be particularly important for us to listen into carefully this morning. For all too often, it's true, I think, in the lives of Christians that although we believe Jesus will return, it doesn't always make a great impact on the way that we live Monday through to Sunday. We need to hear and to heed Paul's urgent call to us today. So do grab a Bible. You may have a paper one. If so, it's on about page 1187, our reading. Or you might have a virtual copy of the Bible. Do look it up. It's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And Paul starts in verses 1 to 3 by reminding us all about the certainty of Jesus' return. He calls this day of Jesus' return the day of the Lord. And that's a phrase that has got a rich Old Testament background. The Jews were expecting a day when God would come and finally defeat his enemies and save his people. They'd had lots of, as it were, mini days of the Lord in the Old Testament. For example, in the book of Exodus, when God brought his judgment upon the Egyptians and rescued his people and took them to the promised land. But that was, if you like, a little foreshadowing of a greater day of the Lord, when Jesus would return. And that's going to be greater because his coming is going to be more extensive and more final than any day that's ever happened in the past. There will be that a day, says Paul, when the risen Jesus will arrive in glory. And Paul wants us to understand that day by giving us two very dramatic, two very arresting images to understand it. He says, verse 2, that it will come like a thief in the night. It's probably fair to say that when thieves plan a visit to our property, they don't send us a letter or an email or a text or a phone call alerting us to their visit. No, they come suddenly, don't they? Often in the night, when people least expect them. Well, says Paul, that's one way of understanding how Jesus will return. He won't come at a time we expect him to come, not a time that we would perhaps choose him to come. He will arrive, but it's the timing of his coming is kept in the secret counsels of God himself. One day he will return, and on that day it is too late for us to make preparations. The second image that Paul uses is perhaps even more arresting. Jesus' coming, says Paul, will be like the labor pains that a pregnant woman experiences. There are, of course, many experiences in life that we can put off for another day. An appointment with the hairdresser, or the dentist, or the trainer at the gym. All of those sorts of things can be put off, can be postponed for another day that's more convenient to us. But there are some experiences, of course, that we can't put off. When a pregnant woman begins to experience labor pains, she can't just say, well, it's not convenient for me to have a baby now. The baby's arrival is imminent. It is inescapable. And Paul says it'll be a bit like that when the Lord Jesus Christ returns from heaven in glory. Nothing we can do will stop him coming. And when he does come, people who've been opposed to him and his rule over their lives will not escape his judgment, verse 3. Destruction will come upon them suddenly, like a river in full flow. Well, put those two images, if you would, in your minds together. Jesus' coming will be like a thief in the night. It will be like the labor pains that a pregnant woman experiences. Taken together, those pictures convey to us the truths that Jesus will certainly return, but he will return at a time we don't expect. And sadly, on that day, many people will not escape the righteous judgment of God on that day. Now, I do realize, of course, that those two pictures are not easy or comfortable for us. They're not things perhaps that we would find easily to explain to friends of ours who don't share our faith. Our world believes that it is master of its own destiny and gives little thought to the concept of God having his sway over their lives. And yet Paul would want us to realize that the coming of Jesus is a truth. It's a truth that we need to believe, to grab hold of, to share, and to live in the light of it. Well, you say to me, okay, well, I understand what you're saying, that Jesus will certainly return, but how do I live in the light of it? That's our second and main theme this morning. How can we get ready for the return of Jesus? And if you look through verses 4 through to 10, you'll see a number of important points here that Paul makes for us. The first thing that he wants to say to us is that we are to realize who you are. Verses 4 and 5. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in the darkness that this day, the day of Jesus' return, should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. Now, this might be a little bit unfamiliar to you as a concept, but bear with it because it's really important. Naturally speaking, we human beings have got minds that are darkened because we live in a world that is often dark. But Jesus came as the light of the world to bring illumination and faith to us. God rescued us, Paul teaches in another letter, Colossians. He rescued us from the dominion of darkness and has brought us into a kingdom that his beloved son Jesus presides over, a kingdom that is full of light. Now, the day of the Lord will be a terrible shock to people in spiritual darkness, people who hadn't realized the perils of their position. The coming of Jesus in his sovereign power will dazzle them because it will expose their sin and leave them helpless and hopeless before a judge of complete moral purity. But, says Paul to us this morning, you are not like them. You are children of the light, children of the day. You know, when you and I became Christians, when we turned to Jesus Christ, God, as it were, put the light on. He made the light of Jesus shine in our hearts. And as we look forward to his coming, well, that light has already dawned. We've seen it, and we look forward, as it were, to the noonday light of dazzling sun when Jesus returns. You do not belong to the darkness, but to the light, says Paul to us this morning. And I think he would encourage us to be constantly reflecting, meditating, glorying in our new identity as children of the light. The best way of avoiding it being Jesus' return being a shock to us is to realize that actually that miracle has happened. We are children of the light, and we will anticipate Jesus' coming all the more as we think of our identity. The second thing that I think Paul says here is that he doesn't want us to go back to the darkness. So then, in verse 6, because you are children of the light, Let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. Paul knew the world. He was a realist. He knew that the night was a time when bad things could happen. People could get drunk. And people tend to get drunk, not at breakfast time or mid-morning or even in the afternoon. But those things tend to happen in the night, can't they? The night time can be a time where all sorts of bad behaviour takes place. It's a time where people are less alert. They're more drowsy and indeed sleep. And what Paul is doing in these verses is applying this everyday truth that bad things happen in the night rather than in the daytime, and he's applying it to our spiritual lives. He wants us to see ourselves as people who have escaped from the grip of the night, as it were, morally and spiritually speaking, and he doesn't want us to regress into that night, allowing ourselves to revert and do again those things that we used to do before we came to faith in Jesus Christ. He's saying to us, look, you Christians, you men and women of the light, you shouldn't be slipping backwards into the dark of moral impurity. That would be as crazy for you as a bride on her wedding day, sort of having a good wallow in the mud before going to the church to meet her bridegroom. Be awake and sober rather than be sleepy and sozzled, Paul is saying to us this morning. And then thirdly, he wants us positively to do something. He wants us to get up and to get dressed to meet Christ. Since we belong to the day, verse 8, we are to dress for the day. I'm sure we realise that we have got different pieces of clothing that we tend to wear for different occasions. Our William has started wearing steel-capped boots for chopping logs in our garden. But he wouldn't wear those boots on a football field or at his end-of-year prom. I used to wear a wig and gown when I went to court, but I didn't used to wear that on my trips to the supermarket. You wouldn't wear pyjamas or nighttime attire when you go out to work in the morning. People would think that was rather extraordinary. Well, Paul is saying that spiritually we are to wear certain clothes as we belong to the day and not the night. He pictures us Christians as being a bit like soldiers. Soldiers engaged in a fierce battle against the world, the flesh, and the devil. And just like a soldier going into fierce combat wears certain pieces of armour, so here Paul describes the pieces of armour that the soldier in his day would have used: a breastplate, something to put on their tummies, and a helmet to put on their heads. And the breastplate that he describes is one of faith, that is an active trust in Jesus Christ, and love, a love particularly for our fellow Christians. Those things, faith and love, are to be put on regularly on our tummies. And then on our heads, we are to cap everything with the sure hope of salvation, a salvation that will be finally completed on the day that Jesus returns. Faith, love, hope, these recur in this letter to the Thessalonians. Indeed, if you know the other New Testament letters, they're often a trio that we'll find. They are things that we should choose to clothe ourselves with daily as good soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ, following him as our commanding officer, ready for whatever opposition and difficulties might come our way. And these pieces of equipment, if you like, will never go out of fashion. When Susan and I were sort of in our 20s, we used to wear sunglasses called Wayfarers, And everyone who was a yuppie in London used to wear them. They've gone out of fashion completely now. You'll never find them on the market. But faith, love, and hope will never go out of fashion. They're what we should be clothing ourselves with daily as we choose to follow Jesus Christ, to grow up in our salvation, to mature, and so become ready for the day of the Lord, that day when we will meet the Lord Jesus and be with him and his people for all eternity. And Paul finishes his rousing comments here by reminding us that this day will certainly happen. We will meet our hero, and our security rests on two things supremely. It rests on the appointment of God and the work of Jesus Christ. We see that in verses 9 and 10, where Paul says, "For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him." Isn't that tremendous? Our confidence for that day, not sort of closing in on us like a trap snaring a mouse, is not our human abilities, our human cleverness, our moral purity. If we relied on those things, we'd be on very shaky ground, because we're all flawed people to a degree, aren't we? No, we're reliant on the grace of God that is to be found in Jesus Christ. Our confidence rests supremely on God appointing us not to suffer the natural consequences of our sins, namely the righteous anger of God, but rather to receive salvation, a salvation that flows and rests supremely on what Jesus did for us on the cross and results in our eternal relationship with God. And therefore, says Paul, in the light of all this, there is a new priority for us to embrace this morning. We are to encourage each other to get ready for the day of the Lord. I think that this is a very important word for us this morning. We are to be encouragers of one another in the Christian faith. We're to be people who constantly remind one another of the deep truths of our faith that unites us, that Jesus did die, he did rise, he did ascend to the Father's right hand in glory. He will one day return to come and meet with us, his people, people who've become by grace children of the light, children of the day. We should be constantly encouraging one another with these truths, exhorting one another not to fall back and slip back into the old ways of darkness, but to dress ourselves regularly with this wonderful clothing of faith, love, and hope. Paul wants us to commit ourselves, or perhaps recommit ourselves, to be encouragers this morning. So easy, isn't it, for us to stand detached from our fellow Christians, to sort of let others get on with their own lives and think it's got nothing to do with us. Or it's easy for us to become those who perhaps criticize others with barbed comments. That's not to be us, says Paul. We are to be those who encourage our Christian brothers and sisters in the Lord with our kind interest, our true words, and our prayers. I wonder how you and I can do that a bit more fully in the coming months. Thank you so much for encouraging one another over these long months of pandemic. Please keep doing that. Please keep thinking of fresh ways of doing it. Now we can meet in gardens. Maybe you could, if you've got a garden, encourage small groups to come and meet you. That could be a good way of encouraging them. Or meeting up for walks. Those are such valuable opportunities. Let's be those who encourage people in the Lord. But I want to address just a final word to those who are listening in and thinking, well, this is all very well for Christians. But what about me, you might be saying? I'm not yet there. I haven't yet embraced Jesus Christ. I wouldn't frankly be ready if he returned this evening and called me to an account for the way I've lived my lives. Well, can I just leave you with two wonderful pieces of news? The first is that today is a day when God would be delighted to do that same miracle for you that he's done for Christians over the centuries. Today could be a day where you come from the dominion of darkness and come into the kingdom of light, a kingdom that is presided over by the Lord Jesus Christ. That miracle can happen even for you as you humble yourself before the Lord, turning away from your sins and turning in wonder to the Lord Jesus Christ. Today could be a wonderful day, a day of deliverance for you. And the second bit of wonderful news is that if you do take that step, you won't be alone. The Lord Jesus will come to you by his Spirit and give you the resources you need to grow in faith, and that you'll be surrounded here at St. Margaret's by a great community of encouragers, people who will help you to grow in love, faith, and hope. Well, let's pause there. Let me give you a moment just to think about what I've said from the scriptures this morning. Perhaps you might want to say a private prayer to the Lord Jesus, and then I'll lead us in a prayer. Father God, we thank you very much indeed that we have this glorious future to look forward to, that history is not circular but linear. It is all leading to something. We thank you that the Lord Jesus Christ will for sure return from heaven. Thank you, Lord, that that affects our future. It also affects the way that we live now. And we pray, Lord, that we would meditate ourselves personally and prayerfully on these truths, and we would be people who live our lives now in the certain truth of your return in glory. Thank you that we can look forward to that great day, a day where we will meet you, meet our fellow Christians, and be with you for eternity. Thank you. We bless you for that in your precious name. Amen. And our next song is one that very much picks up the fact that there is a day that we all look forward to. We did have it sung to us last week, and it may have been new for some of us. I hope that this great truth of there is a day is something that perhaps we'll want to sing along with at our homes as we rejoice in the certainty of this day.
There is a day 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 5. You are all children of the light and children of the day. Father, we thank you that we do not live in darkness, but in the light of Christ. May his light shine upon us, and as we pray, may the light of his word shine through our prayers. As we come to prayer, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. May we begin our prayers for Her Majesty the Queen at this time of bereavement. We pray that God will strengthen her inwardly. May she know the full dimensions of God's love for her. And as she begins to think about the future, both for herself personally and in her constitutional responsibilities, we pray for the Lord's gentleness and leading. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The mission of the month is Fever Radio, and has been reporting that during the pandemic, audience levels have been at record levels. So we give thanks for that. Fever Radio and their partners are requesting prayers for students in a media project based in Central Asia, for Radio Wimbi in Mozambique, and protection from growing terrorist insurgency, for Kyrgyzstan and FEBC's radio ministry, also in the midst of an ongoing political situation. Gracious Father, come who came into the world as the Word made flesh. May Fever Radio enable the Word of Christ to take root in the lives of people throughout its area of service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. It is the anniversary of Elsie's baptism, and so we pray for her and her parents, Steve and Carolyn. May the resurrection power of Jesus be manifest in this home and in Elsie's life to the glory of Jesus. May we also for a moment lift before God any who are bereaved, at end of life care, and any who are unwell. One name to mention is Arnold's. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The annual parochial church meeting is taking place later on this morning, and it seems to be hot on the heels of the last one, which was delayed many months. We pray for the PCC and the wardens, the staff team, and all who hold positions of responsibility. May God grant those in leadership over us vision and energy as they seek to spearhead the mission and ministry of St. Margaret's Church. May you grant to St. Margaret's all the resources of money, time, and talents that are needed to fulfil the purposes of God for St. Margaret's over the next few years. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Matt and Sarah and Amelia as they prepare to start ordination training, asking that you provide for their needs and future. We also pray that the Lord will draw to St. Margaret's a leader to continue the good work that Matt has started or continued with the under-18s and families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The collect for the fourth Sunday of Easter. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the order of sin and death, to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. And as our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, thank you for joining us today. It's been great to be together. As we close our service, let's tell our story. Let's speak the words of the creed of our faith together. Speak this with me. At home, you may like to stand up and say this with gusto and belief, let's say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, two notices quickly before you go. If you're a lady, then do take notice of the Women's Together meeting on Saturday morning. No sign-ups required for that one. Women's Together on Saturday morning is going to be great. I've personal knowledge of the speaker, and I can tell you it's going to be a good one. Do also just make sure noted in your diaries is our prayer meeting on Wednesday, the 5th of May. So easy to get there for an hour on Zoom. Do come and join us. All the information you need is in your newsletter, so do make sure you're getting that. Check it in your emails. So let's pray to close. Father, we do thank you for sending your Son, Jesus. Thank you that he died for our sins and he rose for our life. May we live the risen life that we're called to, led by your Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen.